WSR has hosted several previous events. Our spring event is sort of our big thing that we look forward to every year. In 2011, we had Emily Towns out here speaking about gender, race, and healthcare. Last year, in 2012, we had Kwok Pui-Lan here in collaboration with the Asia Project at the GTU and the Pacific Asian and North American Asian Women in Theology and Ministry annual conference. This evening, we are thrilled to welcome Dr. Monica Coleman, Dr. Keri Day, and Dr. Andrea White, who will be introduced to you very shortly. I want to remind you that tomorrow there is a continuation of this event that you are all certainly welcome to, and that will be held tomorrow morning at 10 o'clock from 10 to 11:30 in the dinner boardroom over on the GTU side of the campus. And this will be a time for informal conversation and coffee with this evening's presenters. So really a wonderful opportunity to be able to be in conversation with them. I would like to express our gratitude to American Baptist Seminary of the West for hosting us this evening, and also our gratitude to the Black Church Africana Religious Studies Certificate Program and the SFTS H. Eugene Farlow Program Fund, who are co-sponsoring these events. I would like to invite our president of ABSW Forward, Dr. Paul Martin, who would like to offer a word of welcome.
Andrea said it so well, so I'm not going to amplify what she has said, except to say we are just ecstatic at the opportunity to be in your presence with this distinguished panel and with the representation that comes from the two programs that are co-sponsors of this. I was telling one of the members that Herman Farlow, as we called him in our family, H. Eugene Farlow, was my cousin. So I can refer to him as Herman when nobody else in this culture can say that of Gene. But it is a joy for us to be the host and for you to be on our campus. We thank God for your presence and looking for a wonderful, wonderful two-day experience with these wonderful persons who have come from afar to celebrate with us in this time. God bless you, and remember, you don't have to have an invitation to come to this hallowed place. You're welcome all the time. God bless you, and let's get it on, okay?
At this time, I would like to invite Dr. Valerie Miles Tribble forward. She is the visiting professor of ministerial leadership and functional theology here at ABSW. She is going to be introducing our presenters this evening. And then after the presentations, there may be some dialogue between the presenters, and then Dr. Miles Tribble will lead us off with a question posed to the panelists. The time remaining will be open for question and answer time, which will be moderated by Dr. Inese Radzins, who is Assistant Professor of Theology and Dorothea Harvey Professor of Swedenborgian Studies at Pacific School of Religion. A reception will follow our presentation this evening, and you are all welcome to remain for that. It will be out these doors and straight across the breezeway, up the stairs and in that building there. So, Dr. Miles Tribble.
It is indeed a pleasure and an honor to introduce these esteemed and brilliant womanist scholars. Let me begin by introducing first Dr. Monica A. Coleman. She is the Associate Professor of Constructive Theology and African American Religions. She is a philosophical theologian who works with a process metaphysic and the Black and womanist theological traditions. Her research interests include process theology, new movements in Black and womanist theologies, African traditional religions, Yoruba-based traditions in the Americas, mental health, and theology and religious pluralism. Dr. Coleman teaches courses on systematic theology, constructive theology, African-American religions, metaphor in and theology, Black and womanist theologies, Whitehead's religious relevance, and sexual violence in faith communities. She is co-director of the Center of Process Studies and co-chair of the Black Theology Group and a member of the steering committee of the Open and Relational Theologies Consultation for the American Academy of Religion. She received her MA at Claremont Graduate University and her PhD at Claremont Graduate University, and she is an ordained elder in the AME Church. Recent publications include Not Alone, Reflections on Faith and Depression, a 40-day devotional published in 2012, Creating Woman's Theology, a movement engaging process thought with co-editor Nancy R. Howell and Helen Talon Russell in 2011. And of course, one that the womanist students should be familiar with here at ABSW, Making a Way Out of No Way, a Womanist Theology, Fortress Press, 2008. Dr. Andrea C. White is the Assistant Professor of Theology and Culture. Dr. White specializes in constructive Christian theology, womanist theology, and postmodern religious thought, with research interests especially in the doctrine of God, theology of otherness, womanist perspectives on theological anthropology, and the relationship between philosophy and theology. Her first book project, The Back of God, A Theology of Otherness in Karl Barth and Paul Ricoeur, places Barth's doctrine of God as wholly other in conversation with Ricoeur's hermeneutic phenomenology of the self as other, and presents the possibility for divine human relation on the basis of transcendence rather than in spite of it. Her second book project, The Black Woman's Bodies and God Politics, A Womanist Theology of Personhood, follows from the study of subjectivity in the first and addresses theological anthropology and narrative identity in womanist thought. Dr. White has received several research grants and fellowships, including the Louisville Institute First Book Grant for Minority Scholars and the Lilly Theological Research Faculty Fellowship from the Association of Theological Schools. She is an ordained American Baptist minister. She received her MDiv at Yale University and her PhD at the University of Chicago. Let us welcome Dr. Andrea C. White. And last but not least, Dr. Keri. Dr. Keri's research interests are in the areas of ethics and society, African-American religious thought, and religion and culture. She has published Theologizing in Black, African-American Theology and the Doctrine of God in the Oxford Handbook of African-American Theology, 2012, in print. She also has published The Ambiguity of Neighbor Love, Reading Agape from the Margins, and she published in Beyond the Pale, Reading Christian Ethics from the Margins, Westminster John Knox Press, 2011. She also has published Forging Community and Communitas Towards a Demasculinization of Christology in Black Churches in Walk Together Children, Black and Womanist Theologies, 2010. She received her MA from Yale University Divinity School and her PhD from Vanderbilt University. Let us welcome Dr. Keri. I will turn it now to our esteemed moderator.
Thank you. So just a brief word on kind of the organization of the evening. Each of our panelists will present their own topics, which we will find out as they are presenting. But they will present for about 15 to 20 minutes. If time allows, they may engage each other at the end of that. So we want to make sure that everyone in the audience also has time to engage. So we're going to play it by ear a little bit and see how much time we have at the end of each of their talks. And we will begin with Andrea White and then move on to Keri Day, and then Monica Coleman will finish us up.
Great. Thanks.
Do we need to hold that?
Can you hear me if I talk like this? You need this.
Okay.
First of all, I want to say thank you so much to Inese Radzins for organizing this. This was actually born in the back of a van on the ride to the airport in Crawfordsville, Indiana, and almost 2 years ago. So it was a brilliant idea. I am so thrilled to be with my friends, my colleagues, brilliant, brilliant sisters. Thank you for organizing this. It's really a thrill to be here. I've been excited about being here for almost 2 years. So thank you, Inese. I know it was a lot of work to organize this. I'm going to share with you a little bit of my own work and my project, my book project called Black Women's Bodies, Womanist Theology of Personhood. But before I do, I just want to say, give a couple preliminary remarks in light of the topic, the theme of our event this evening, and regarding the future of the discipline of womanist theology and ethics. And the first thing I want to say is I want to point very specifically to the work of Monica and Keri in the way that they have really opened up the field of womanist theology and womanist ethics. And first, I want to point to Monica's piece that she wrote about, depending on how you calculate the date it was written or when it was published, it was about 6 or 7 years ago when she wrote a piece called Must I Be Womanist? And in that piece, I'm so glad to see heads nodding. In that piece, I consider this a groundbreaking piece because there were three very specific critiques of the discipline of womanist theology that happened in that piece. First of all, the critique that womanist theology needed to be more political, it needed to address religious pluralism, and it needed to address heterosexism in the discipline and in theology in general. And that piece really, really opened the doors for a conversation beyond just Christian theology and womanist, in the womanist discipline. And Keri Day's work, her recent book called Unfinished Business, addresses another critique that has been launched against the discipline, namely the critique that womanist theology has always prided itself on dealing with tripartite forms of oppression, sex, gender, and class. It's actually sex and gender are one, race and class oppression. And the critique is that womanist theology and ethics has actually done very little to address the issue of class. And when we say class, it's often, I think Keri actually taught me this, it's often a euphemism for poverty, right? And so Keri's book, Unfinished Business, is finally addressing this hole in the literature. And I just wanted to highlight that because I think they're really exemplar for where our field is going. I think they are the future. So, and hopefully together we all are broadening what it means to be do womanist theology. And the last thing I'll say before I begin my own remarks about my own project is that the work of womanist theology is also characteristically more transdisciplinary, and that is evident in Keri's work, it's evident in Monica's work, it's evident in my own, which you'll see in just a moment. The way in which Keri addresses public policy and political science and social sciences and ethics, all the while with theology as subtext running through her work, and the way in which Monica is brilliantly joining process thought with a very, very dense philosophy of religion with womanist issues is really quite a feat. So all of these, I think, are good examples of what the discipline of womanist theology will look like as we move into the future. So those are just a few preliminary remarks. Now, when theologians ask, what is womanist theology? The query may be a reproach in disguise. as it betrays a certain skepticism about what counts as theological in womanist theology. In its more nuanced form, the question about its qualifications as a theological enterprise implies that the study of African-American women's religious experience relative to the tripartite form of race, class, and gender oppression does not immediately present itself as a theological project. African-American women's religious experience is the subject matter of critical social theory, anthropology, sociology, religious history, but not theology. My paper relies on the premise that womanist theology is indeed theological, not because it is a special case, not because we must stretch or distort the parameters of the theological canon, but precisely because womanist theology is theological in a most paradigmatic sense. The theological nature of the discipline begins with understanding womanist theology as fundamentally a theology of otherness, and I'm going to tell you what I mean by that. Now, when theology thinks the problem of otherness, it often turns straight away to the doctrine of God. From the prophet Job to theologian Karl Barth, to think otherness is to think God, who is radically transcendent, supremely and wholly other. Yet there is a distinctly different quagmire in the problem of otherness that brings with it a whole host of complexities, and that is the scandal of flesh. Phenomenologist Jean-Luc Marion insists that within the problematic of otherness, the greater difficulty is not transcendence, but immanence. Marion inverts the terms of the alterity question, the otherness question, that's ubiquitous throughout the history of Christian thought and persistent in postmodern religious thought, and identifies immanence as the significant problem of the other. The difficulty of the other, he says, lies not in its supposed distancing, poverty, or transcendence. It lies, on the contrary, in its absolute immanence. Immanence and embodiment are problems subject to theological interrogation because of the scandal of flesh. The scandal is not radical alterity, but embodiment. Now, this is not to say that transcendence and embodiment are oppositional, but to suggest that the tenacious preoccupation with transcendence has distracted theological attention from what is arguably a greater difficulty. The precarious nature of encounter with the other, even our vulnerability before the other, is not due to the inaccessibility of the abstract other, but to the immediacy of the flesh. The other appears indirectly and yet all the more immediately. So on this view, when it comes to the otherness of God, it is actually conceptually easier to contend with the notion that God is God than it is to grapple with God made flesh. What are we to make of this claim when the scandal of flesh is a question not only of alterity, but when flesh is tied up with otherness meant in its most pejorative sense? When the scandal of flesh refers, for example, to depictions of black women's bodies. Now, Jean-Luc Marion, a French phenomenologist, is not the first thinker who comes to mind in critical social or race theory, yet consider his claim that racism and genocide are the logical consequence of weak arguments for the other. Analogy, empathy, and language, to name a few, are probable arguments for another flesh, and while such arguments might be enough to support the presumption of the other, they never manifest the other straight on. Above all, they do not provide resistance to violent denials of flesh. Racism and the global killing it logically implies exploits the weakness of these arguments for another flesh. Now, however wrought with difficulty, a womanist theological anthropology is inherently a question of flesh. Womanist theology is recognized largely for its contributions to atonement theory, with its productive critiques against redemptive suffering. Its insights have challenged conceptions of servanthood, surrogacy, and sacrifice, all that glorify black women's subordination based on deeply embedded views of black female bodies. Building on these insights, I want to foreground the negative iconography of black women with the aim of demythologizing black female imagery. But beyond a merely deconstructive task, the larger aim is to suggest alternatives for understanding human personhood in general and a theology of black female bodies in particular. Now, presumably, a womanist theological anthropology would begin with the assertion that, despite dehumanization, black women image God because black women are beautiful and black women are strong. But this formulation, in the name of reclaiming the body, gives an anthropological rather than a theological starting point to a doctrine of the Imago Dei, and it perpetuates that thing we always worry about that reduces theology to anthropology. Moreover, it is ironically dehumanizing as it reinforces the strong black woman motif that has become socially prescriptive and a function of a rigidly fixed identity. Political scientist Melissa Harris Perry says that when African-American women call themselves strong, it is a triumph of emotional and political resistance. But when black women are expected to be super strong, they cannot be simply human. What begins as empowering self-definition can quickly become a prison, she says. The strong black woman imperative is unusual because it requires tremendous personal fortitude from a group with few structural resources. It thus exposes black women to more opportunities for shaming. As a womanist theological anthropology addresses the question of the Imago Dei, the problem of representation and the subject of embodiment are immediately foregrounded. When we consider the manner in which history and contemporary culture have represented the creatureliness of black women, our gaze is immediately turned to her body, which is imaged as base and carnal. Her embodied representation of the sexually unclean means that black women's creatureliness is ironically both a source of shame and an instrument of seduction and production. However we construe it, black female flesh is represented as inherently sinful. In this identification of black women with the creaturely, such representations remain invested in conceiving black women as property and confining, indeed enslaving, her body. Working against these delegitimizing images, the Imago Dei, grounded upon the notion of God become flesh, reclaims the body in all its fleshly creatureliness as a site for grace, in protest against savage imagery, and as an occasion for imaging God as an ethical task. Establishing the Imago Dei as normative advances a theological case for divine affirmation of the body. Now, when womanist theology takes on the question of flesh, it must negotiate a dialectic. The dialectic between the body as a site for grace and the body is a site for ideological inscription. Bodies are texts upon which ideologies are inscribed, and the black body especially is a cartography of power dynamics. Anthony Pinn explains, power relations are not simply thought, but are performed through the placement of real fleshly bodies in space and time. The body is a story told to support the social system. In this regard, the body is not simply a biological material reality, but also a cultural production subject to the conditions of a market economy. We know well the story of black women's bodies as objects of exchange in a slave economy with its relentless hold on hegemonic power. Katie Cannon puts it this way: heteropatriarchs have worked out, have worked on, and have inscribed their death-dealing ideologies, theologies, and systems of value on the canvas that is the flesh of black people. Our bodies are the texts that carry the memories. The flesh of African American women is the text on which androcentric patriarchy is written. Carol Boyce Davies describes the ironic twist of black women's subjectivity being silenced by this violent discursive practice. She writes, "The subaltern woman as subject is already positioned, represented, spoken for, or constructed as absent or silent, or not listened to in a variety of discourses. Her speech is already represented as non-speech." Not only is her subjectivity an unspoken discourse, but the practice of ideological inscription upon the body also goes unnoticed, and therefore uninterrogated. Pinn accounts for such disregard by describing the nonverbal dimension of the body that renders bodies non-written texts. The body speaks a world without uttering a single word. Harlem's going to make sure that doesn't happen to her. It is through critique of ideological inscription that the body becomes a silent partner laid bare. The body as text, as that which is constricted by ideology, must be distinguished from embodied subjectivity that exceeds and resists ideological inscription. So we have come up against a paradox. The simultaneous inscription of a symbol system upon the black female body as text and the non-speech of her embodied subjectivity. The black female body is read but unwritten, inscribed but not spoken. This non-speech is the result of a violent act of coding as natural what is in fact distorted identity. Black women's identity seems inextricably bound to servanthood, surrogacy, and sacrifice, to mammy, matriarch, welfare queen, and Jezebel. But the solution is not so easily carried out, or for that matter, so obviously recognized. It is not simply a matter of speaking, of erasing ideological inscription in order to write another text. The desire to speak meets up with the paradoxical challenge of attempting to communicate what is incommunicable. The pain of evil and suffering that has been the mechanism of ideological inscription and subjective prescription in the first regard. A phenomenology of pain shows the utter inexpressibility and cultural invisibility of dehumanization. But if black women's bodies' experience of suffering cannot be articulated, then her body becomes the black hole, so to speak, as one scholar puts it, within and against which all interpretive discourse can only come to a halting stop. Removing the status of invisibility is prerequisite for demythologizing the idolatrous imaging of black female bodies. Black female bodies function as part of a pervasive yet largely uninterrogated cultural myth. As oversexed, black women are always ready for sex. Therefore, sexual violence to the black female body is not logically possible. It does no injury to her, but rather the very presence of her seducing body does injury to men. As womanist scholar Kelly Brown Douglas contends, it is virtually impossible for black women to step out of the character of Jezebel. Theological response must recast human subjectivity in light of the imago Dei and affirm embodiment on precisely theological grounds, reclaiming the body, yet without reducing black women's identity to their bodies. Such a revisionist theological anthropology is distinctly womanist because it demonstrates how moral agency is negotiated when autonomy and self-definition cannot be taken for granted. Because the notion that the body is threatening, if not regulated by cultural processes, is an enduring theme in Western philosophy, religion, and art, and because black women's bodies as icons of sexual deviance pose this threat acutely, I grant hermeneutical privilege to black women's embodied lived experience. Some would go so far to say there is no body so dehumanized, yet rejecting any suggestion of competing oppressions, the hermeneutical privilege is based on the premise that the intersection of gender, race, and class oppression is a distinctive form of dehumanization that is idiosyncratic to black women's experience. There is something both cliche and tautological about a womanist theology of embodiment. Arguably, a womanist theological anthropology is foremost a theology of the body because to give an account of the human person from a womanist theological perspective is to address human persons not only as created, but as gendered and racialized, which necessarily entails giving an account of embodiment. It is in this sense that a womanist theology of the body is tautological. But it involves a dangerous cliche that can lead to the reduction of black women's experience to their bodies. Womanist theology, therefore, must be not merely descriptive, but disruptive. Womanist theology claims African American women's religious experience always marked by the intersection of race and gender oppression, as a methodological starting point. But this ought not entail a fetishization of oppression. We do not wish to romanticize gender and race oppression. And neither do we wish to claim that oppression exhaustively defines black women's identity, which in itself would be a dehumanizing act. So the deconstructive task of identifying exclusion, marginality, exploitation, and violence cannot be all we have to say about Black women's identities and bodies. As one womanist scholar puts it, womanist identity must move beyond ontological Blackness by recognizing that Black subjectivity is not a static, reified artifact. Womanist identity allows for multiple performances of gender, race, and sexuality, always resisting totalization and closure. To speak of Black women and their bodies as gendered and racialized is not to suggest a lack of agency in the economy of social construction. Black women are not passive recipients of racialization and gendered identity constructions. Womanist theology must not perpetuate the victimization motif that renders her an essentialized object of study as an historical phenomenon. To talk about the grip of culture on the body casts active subjects as passive dupes of ideology and overlooks the gaps and the unstable and open nature of all cultural texts. It is to fail to acknowledge the cultural work by which fragmented active subjects confound dominant discourses. There are obvious political and ethical reasons for redefining identity away from exclusion and oppression, but there is also a theological reason. When we do violence to Black women's subjectivity, we betray not only the humanity of Black women, not only the humanity of human beings in general, but as womanist Sean Copeland so powerfully reminds us, we betray the humanity of God. I am going to make an executive decision here because I really would rather hear from my colleagues. And let's see if I can do this without breaking the flow of my argument. So I'll conclude with this. A phenomenological analysis of flesh is relevant for a womanist theological anthropology because of the challenge to conceive how Black women's bodies may participate in the image of God when they are fashioned as icons of sexual deviance. I have suggested it is not enough simply to reclaim the body in a way that inverts the binary of mind and body, yet still keeps it in play. Rather, it is more effective to displace the narrative of mind-body dualism altogether. But we want to abolish the mind-body problem without sacrificing the body, for to do so would paradoxically reinforce the idolatrous gaze upon the body. We discard the body only because it has the potential to seduce our gaze with its deviance. We have accomplished this displacement, I contend, by replacing the metaphysical category of body with the phenomenon of flesh, thereby subverting altogether the body problem and the accompanying narrative of sexual deviance. Precisely because flesh is not an object available to the gaze, the self-other relation is possible. This is profoundly productive for a womanist understanding of relationality because it avoids altogether the logical implications of object possession when the self-other relation is construed in terms of subject and object. There is no possession of the other or securing of the self in terms of the self. The other is never possessed. One can only possess a body, and in that case, possession closes access to the flesh. In the eroticization of the flesh, no one possesses anyone or finds herself possessed, for no flesh dominates as flesh or finds itself dominated. Flesh is not something to be possessed, for I do not have flesh, I am flesh. A phenomenology of the flesh aids in the task to demonstrate how womanist theology is fundamentally a theology of otherness. This is not merely a political claim about how Black women are othered, but a theological claim about the affirmation of flesh in and through the scandal of flesh that is the incarnation. Prima facie, attending to flesh in a womanist project may have the appearance of reifying the identification of Black women with their bodies, of perpetuating the self-contempt that grows out of unwitting acceptance of cultural images of Black women's identity. But only as a thoroughgoing theological project does womanist theology have the power to subvert the narrative of disdain for Black women's bodies and to view the body as a site for grace. Thank you.
Thank you. And Keri will be next.
Good evening.
Good evening. Thank you, Dr. White. And perhaps to provide a little coherence so it doesn't seem like we're sort of speaking about very different things. I really appreciated you lifting up sort of real issues of embodiment and how that sort of opens up possibilities in terms of the theological moment. And I think that, as I'll talk about, as I consider myself a social ethicist and social critic, and as a social ethicist and social critic that does class analysis, I think it is important to remember, and I mean, of course, you implicitly and explicitly actually as well, allude to this, that black women's bodies, however, are positioned, are economically positioned in different ways, right? So when we talk about what are the ways in which middle-class black women's bodies are positioned, for example, in relationship to poor black women's bodies, right? That different kinds of discussions then emerge, different kinds of questions are raised in relationship to the material conditions out of which these women's bodies are being read against, so to speak. So that's really helpful. And so a little bit about myself. I do religious studies and theology as a social ethicist and a social cultural critic. At the intersections of theology, religion, and a critique of political economy. I primarily draw on the work of Frankfurt School social critical theory, such as Jürgen Habermas, as well as Walter Benjamin, and also do a lot of, use a lot of feminist critical theorists such as Selah Benabib and Nancy Fraser. And for me, sort of this entire discussion, going back to your analysis of sort of the issue of embodiment within womanist discourse, and the reason why for me it is really important to talk about the increasing significance of class is, you know, we can go back to discussions, for example, in the 1960s, where for African-American communities, there was not only an experience of community, but communitas, right? This intersubjective experience and awareness, but that this intersubjective experience and awareness, it came out of a very unified and shared experience of structural racism in this country, right? So that, for example, whether you were an affluent black woman or whether you were more, as I'll talk about, underclass population black woman, when you got on the bus, you went to the back. Right? So there was a way in which race overdetermined and structured the life chances, the cultural life chances at least, of African Americans here in this country. Part of what my work talks about is with the shift in really global political economy, but with shifts in American political economy beginning in the 1970s, that it began creating greater economic stratification at least. Within African American communities, and there are many other variables in terms of when we talk about should you need to.
Can you hold the mic?
Oh, I'm so
lower.
Sorry. Well, it's a little loud. Okay. When you talk about diversity and multiplicity, I mean there are also cultural forms of diversity and multiplicity, but economic and class stratification absolutely became more pronounced. I mean, one of the greatest dilemmas. The end of the 1960s was how could it be at the height of civil rights legislation, all of the particular gains that we had, could there be an increasing growing underclass, right? This was the dilemma, this was the problematique, that with increasingly middle-class, African-American middle-class populations growing, that sort of what paralleled is a growing black underclass, and really I would argue an American underclass. This is important to womanist work, at least from a social science standpoint, and to the way we theologize, as I'll talk about a bit later. It's important to womanist theology and ethics because when we talk about, for example, womanist theology and ethics is grounded in the lived experiences of black women, the question is who are we talking about when we refer to black women, right? Not the monolithic or the essentialized black woman, but in terms of my work, economic position, who are we talking about when we talk about African-American women, and particularly woman's theology and ethics has always made a claim to lift up the experiences of poor black women in particular, has been the claim throughout much of the literature. So that when we're talking about, again, middle class, African-American life chances, that African-American middle-class women experience, I would argue, race and gender and sexuality in qualitatively different ways than economically deprived African-American women. And so for me, sort of given this this insight that my particular work has grappled with, a book that I just published called Unfinished Business, there were three observations that I wanted to talk about from a social ethicist perspective. And I also want to say this, and I'll briefly hit on this at the very end of my talk. And as a scholar that primarily does class analysis and employs womanist methodologies. I want to be clear that I don't consider myself a womanist scholar. I'm going to talk a little bit about that, but rather I employ womanist methodologies. But what I do want to say is this: I am in no way trying to set one over up against the other, as if to talk about womanist methodologies is then to negate, right, the possibility of naming oneself as a womanist. I'm not doing that kind of work. It's not an either or, right? It can be a both and, but I wanted to make that distinction because I think oftentimes there's not that distinction. I'll talk a bit about that. But in terms of the reason why it is significant for a womanist discourse to begin talking about the increasing significance of class, number one, this is both a theoretical and substantive issue, I would argue. It's methodological and it's substantive. And I've talked a little bit about sort of the substantive aspect of, you know, middle class, you know, affluent to middle class black women, you know, juxtaposed to poor black women. But it's also a theoretical issue. The question is, at least in my mind, as I begin doing research as a class, as a person that does class analysis, why has there been an absence of a critique of political economy in womanist work, right? I mean, because clearly, for example, in black feminist work, that has actually been there, right? And for me, I would argue that a lot, at least methodologically speaking, first wave womanism with a lot of the literary criticism, like for example, Katie Cannon, was drawn off of black feminist work. And I know there are a lot of debates on how you relate black feminism to womanism, but I think that it's reasonable to argue that methodologically, womanism in a lot of ways has gotten its cue from black feminism methodologically. So the question of why hasn't womanism, why hasn't there been a critique of political economy? And I think I must say this, broadly within the humanities, particularly within cultural studies and black cultural studies, I think that there has been this move over the last few decades in light of particularly Marxism and sort of the collapsing of culture into economy, right? So that culture, at least theoretically, is seen as epiphenomenal of economy, right? Culture is nothing but sort of the mirroring the economic base, right? So it's this movement of historical materialism that in a lot of ways, culture is so economically determined that it doesn't have a grounding of its own. And I think that in the last few decades, a lot of cultural theorists in particular, and I think for theology, this has been the case as well, of trying to avoid this very crude Marxism, right? But I also think that what's been lost in that, and I need to take a drink right quick here so I don't cough. I think what's been lost in that is, what's been gained, maybe I should say, is sort of this move towards looking at the symbolic and linguistic grounding of cultural forms, right, and as discrete and separate. And so that's been important. But I think in a lot of ways, it's missed, again, the material realities that in some ways are conditioning the cultural forms that we're talking about. For example, racism. Thomas Holt has an amazing book called Race in the 21st Century, The Problem of Race in the 21st Century, very thin book. And part of his argument is that when you turn to racism, what you actually see is that with each racial regime, there has always been, it's always been linked and expressed forms of political economy that has been interwoven into the ways in which political and political economic decisions have been made. And so I think that within cultural studies, as well as within womanism, this is what's been lost, is what are the ways in which economy interplay with how we understand racism, how we understand the formation of gender and sexuality, for example, with sexuality. What are the ways in which heteronormativity has actually commodified sexuality, particularly women's sexuality? We can turn to human trafficking right now and see these links, right? And so this is very important. What I'm trying to say, I guess, is that while there's been an emphasis on the politics of recognition, that is, issues of identity and difference and the like, there hasn't been an equal emphasis on the politics of redistribution, right? That is, how do we think about the economic ordering of society that has a logic of its own, that cannot totally be made reducible to a politics of recognition? And I think that this is important because I think that often what is misunderstood is that economic inequalities are simply expressions of cultural hierarchies in which maldistribution can be remedied indirectly through a politics of recognition. That is, indirectly through, in other words, if black women and their difference could simply be recognized, then that would lead to devalued identities, and simultaneously it would attack deep sources of economic inequality. So here part of the move is that a politics of recognition begins to displace a politics of redistribution. The argument is that if we offer solutions in the realm of culture, if we offer solutions in terms of a politics of recognition, in terms of recognizing the unique identity and differences of others, that then inequality and economic inequity can be remedied. And what I would argue is that this theoretical assumption is fundamentally wrong, right? That there are ways in which, as I talked about, a politics of redistribution and economic ordering has a different logic unto itself, such as free market enterprise, the free market models. What leads into that is the commodification, even of human subjects and of human labor. And this is not only being experienced by brown and black bodies, this is being experienced by poor, rural, white bodies, right? And this is part of the class analysis in terms of when we're talking about a politics of redistribution, that it becomes clear that it's not, when we're talking about, for example, poor black women, that it's not simply made reducible to race. Right? That race doesn't capture the ways in which, at least economically, they're experiencing institutions. So then my work shows how a politics of redistribution and a politics of recognition are discrete yet interrelated in talking about issues of economic justice. So then in this way, the critique of political economy matters in a fundamental way. It is actually, I'm resuscitating a neo-Marxian critique, right, of how we go about understanding cultural forms of oppression through turning to the material base and the ways in which economics conditions how we are experiencing those particular cultural forms. And this is important, a couple of reasons. The first reason, I would argue, is it allows, for example, womanist theology and ethics to not only turn to intergroup difference, that is critiquing white supremacy, but also it turns to intragroup difference. The ways in which forms of difference internal to black communities are death dealing. And this is very important. So what does it mean to talk about just not the ways in which racism structures the chances of blacks and black women, but patriarchy, sexism, sexuality, and class, and the like. And this is really important. So that, and this is important because I think that oftentimes, and the idea of whiteness, and this is very important, whiteness as a category is very important, right, to how we talk about race and racisms. But oftentimes, the category of whiteness can eclipse how we talk about intragroup difference. And even, for example, how we talk about notions and ideas of blackness moving into the 21st century. Here we're talking about postmodern, right, notions of blackness in which it becomes really important to talk about differences, one of which I talk is about class. And then in terms of theology, my book, Unfinished Business, it actually turns to black churches as one black religious institution that needs to grapple with class differences in order to strengthen not only how it attends to the least of these within its own communities, being poor black women, who constitute over 80% of black church spaces, right? Over 80%, but also it strengthens the democratic project of economic justice here in America. So for me, the theological moment, for example, would be turning to prosperity gospel, which directly negatively affects how we envision the poor. I mean, there have been numerous studies that have been done that have shown first that our denominations and our churches tend to be organized along class lines. Yes. But not only that, there's been numerous studies among black theological scholars that show that middle class black communities feel they oftentimes have no responsibility to those who are deprived, not only within their own community, sitting within their own churches. And a part of, for example, prosperity gospel, the prosperity gospel movement, is a certain envisioning of the poor that is not really in keeping with a vision that honors really the unique experiences of deprivation and even some of the ways in which the poor are transcending and making meaning on an everyday basis despite their economic hardships. So a part of the theological moment, I would argue, is saying that before we can even have an honest discussion about prosperity gospel and create new ways of envisioning the poor in healthy ways, as well as I would argue, I mean, healthy ways of redefining prosperity itself away from the rabid individualism of market economy, is turning to what's really going on within our economic institutions, that it's not, you know, that poor black women are pimping the system, pimping the system based off their reproductive capabilities and raising criminal black children. We need to talk about the absence of a living wage. We need to talk about the ways in which policy structures problems with childcare and healthcare. All of these elements that then begin to challenge a certain reading of the poor here in this country, and I'll add this again, which goes across racial categories, right? I mean, I think there's a way in which black women are stigmatized and incur the burden, right, of these vicious cultural attacks. But let's be clear, the poor in general, across racial categories, are oftentimes stigmatized in ways that are untrue and that mask the severe, atrocious economic inequities that are present within our present markets. And so I'll leave it there in terms of class, and hopefully we can open the discussion up more in terms of the idea of class. But I wanted to finally comment on this methodological issue in talking about, I use womanist methodologies. And don't necessarily name myself as a womanist scholar. Womanist theology and ethics ascribes Alice Walker's work, Alice Walker in particular, as a progenitor of the movement in terms of the idea of womanish and womanist. And of course, for Walker, when you turn to her literature, she understands the idea of womanist first to be used by the black feminist or feminist of color. And I want to repeat that again, the black feminist or the feminist of color. What is interesting is that when you look at how Walker describes, in Search of Our Mother's Gardens, describes the term womanish and womanist, that she actually is using it as a trope, as an adjectival term that can be used to describe the lived experiences of women of color. Oftentimes, that's a different shade than at that time white women. What's been interesting is the ways in which womanist the idea of womanist has been appropriated in womanist theology and ethics, I would argue has foreclosed some of our conversations, at least at the methodological level, is that it has primarily been used as an ontological signifier. And that is that womanish or womanist has been made reducible to what it means to be a black woman. So therefore, one cannot be womanist unless one is a black woman. One cannot name oneself as perhaps doing womanist work unless one is seen at least sort of quote unquote ontologically as black. And for me, as I understand Walker, that for her, this term was to be used in a tropological sense that made room for both the black feminist and the feminist of color. Like, for example, Kwok Poulon identifies as a womanist, the Asian theological scholar as a womanist, was to be used for the black feminists or feminists of color as a way of talking about their unique experiences of race, gender, class, sexuality, and more. And I'm wondering that in womanist being used within womanist theology and ethics, primarily as an ontological signifier, what has been lost in that? And I'm wondering that in sort of, in a lot of ways, reclaiming the idea of womanist in a tropological way, going back to Alice Walker, how does this open up womanist studies to the postmodern moment in terms of identity and who can claim to do the work of womanism? Which brings me to why I speak of doing womanist methodologies. In that for me, part of that commitment is the commitment of understanding womanist religious studies, a womanist theology and ethics, as a space wherein women across multiple ethnic identities can actually participate in the doing of womanist work. However, it is important to note, and I just want to be clear, and we can have more discussion about this, is I think that it is important to note that, you know, there has to be a sense of creativity in the ways in which particular discourses appropriate terms. So I don't want to negate, right, that there are particular ways in which womanist theology and ethics has appropriated the idea of womanist in ways that do work for them. But I'm wondering what has been lost and what are the ways in which possibilities can be opened up in terms of the doing of womanism and womanist methodologies by the reclamation, really by turning back to Alice Walker and to its tropological use instead of seeing a womanism as an ontological signifier. So I'm gonna stop here.
Okay, so Keri, I as we were planning out the event, we were talking about it before we came here this evening. Keri said that she would probably speak the least.
And I spoke the longest. Let me just say, I come out of Pentecostalism, the church of God, and I were known to be long-winded. So that's my excuse.
No, it was great. I just had to talk about it. And last but not least, Monica Coleman. This one.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I'd like to echo what my colleague Andrea said, and what a pleasure it is to be here. And as I go back to our Vanderbilt days, and if you're in an institution where your master's and doctoral students get to blend together, as Vanderbilt did in the way it built community, it makes such a big difference for just your life and your friendships and the people you get to know and meet. And so I'm grateful for knowing you, Inez, and for just getting to be here with friends, talking about a field that really does matter to us. So I wanted to put a timer on to see how long I'm going.
I'll do that next time.
No, it's all good.
And in a way, go back to what Andrea talked about when she mentioned the Must Be Womanist article. Because when I wrote the article, I wasn't trying to lay out the future of womanist theology and ethics. I was just writing down things that my friends and I talked about. It wasn't like I was the only one having these thoughts. I just wanted to write it down. And apparently, I lost hope. Like, who are those people? Where they go? But one of the things that I talked about in the article is kind of what's next at the very end. And I had what I thought was a throwaway comment, saying, maybe it's a third wave, like in feminism. Maybe we'll have third wave feminism. And I just haven't been able to shake that concept. And So I'm going to talk a little about what I mean by third wave just a little bit, because the book coming out any day now, you can pre-order on Amazon.com or go to the Fortress website, shameless plug, called Eighth Eye Womanist 2, Third Wave Womanist Religious Thought, where I have a lengthy discussion on what I think I mean by third wave womanist religious thought. But what I was trying to get at with the article was why it is that given the option, some women call themselves black feminists and some women call themselves women. And being mentored, being having good friends who call themselves black feminists, some call themselves womanists, I was just kind of like, why is that, right? What seems to be some of the differences and distinctions? It was something I could feel but couldn't really name. And so I was trying to kind of name out what it was I thought that womanists did, that black feminists didn't do very well, which was clearly religion, and what it is that black feminists did that womanists didn't do very well, which I thought were politics, dealing with sexual difference in a much better way, and things they've been doing since the 70s, so it wasn't like it was hard to do, right? And talking about religious diversity. As I had to kind of think more concretely, well, what would the third wave be? I actually was asked to write a book about third wave womanist religious thought, and I said, I don't have 200 pages on that. I don't think it's that interesting. And one of my friends said, the editor who I was working with said, well, what would the field look like if it looked the way you want it to look? And I said, now that's a fun question. Like, what kind of work would be being done? You know, and that actually I found really compelling. And so not only did I get to collect some of my friends who are doing really cool work, and through limitations didn't get to include everyone who I wanted to, but then begin to say, and like kind of gathered just, I said, give me what you're working on. And I began to look at that, well, are these falling into categories? What is it that makes these people somehow aggregate, right, that puts their ideas together? And as it turned out, wow, they did fall under some of the areas in which I was critiquing in the early article, dealing with politics, dealing with sexual difference, dealing with religious diversity, and then dealing with other category is dealing with popular culture, right? And that's really fun stuff that I almost got kicked out of my publisher for. Like, you can't write that down in print? I'm like, sure you can. No, you can't. You'll if you really read it, you'll know which articles those are. I'm like, what is it? You'll do it all the time. But religion people don't often use some of the language that is used in some of the articles. But one thing that I began to think about in terms of what makes something womanist, right? I'm still using the term third wave womanist, so I'm not kicking it to the curb altogether. I'm not saying it's useless, it needs to be transcended. That's not really where I am. Is that it still puts black women's religiosity at the center of the discourse. And I think it's important to remember that's still kind of a big deal. Like, I am the only black woman in process theology, still. Right? Not because I set out to be. I didn't know there were other black women when I went into it. I thought it was interesting. Then I got there and I was like, look at all the white men. Right? I was like, there are women, but they were no, and there's some black men. But I wasn't like, oh, I'm going to go be the pioneer in womanist process thought. I was just doing what I found interesting and looked up and realized, wow, it's kind of lonely here. Right? So, it's still, in so many disciplines, a big deal to put black women's religious experiences at the center of what you're doing. And I think it's important to say that that's still, unfortunately, not gotten old, right? So in theology and ethics, there are people who are doing that, but there are still a lot of fields where, I mean, do you know any of the black women working on Mario?
No.
Right? I mean, so it's not like... Like, we've just evolved so much that we can't still be the first black woman working in, or the first person who is comparing black women's religious experiences to such and such. And what I found was that because I was reading whatever, for me, philosophy of religion or philosophical theology, through my feminist and womanist and black studies eyes, which is my background, I saw things my colleagues didn't see, right? Because that's what I brought with me to the reading experience. And so I said, well, don't you see such and such? And they would say, no. I'm like, really? It's the first thing I saw. And because this was how I was looking at something or how I was hearing it. And so I began to realize that for me, part of what my academic calling is, so to say, was to put people in conversation who are not ordinarily in conversation with each other. So to put fields in conversation that were not ordinarily in conversation with each other. Not because it was something that just had to be done, but I was doing it in my head and realized it wasn't being done. And that both of our fields could grow from that kind of conversation. So one thing that I talk about what it means to be third wave is that it's still important to say that Black women's religious experiences can be at the center of the work that we do, the center of our discourse. But as a third waver, what we do is we trouble what it means to be Black women and religious, right? So long, womanist theology has assumed we know what it means to be Black, what it means to be a woman, and what it means to be religious. When, you know, it's the 21st century, we know those are really complex categories, right? Starting with Blackness, right? Well, what does Black mean? Right, we've assumed that Blackness means, you know, African-American descendant of the U.S. slavery system, subject to a one-drop rule experience, right? But we know that Black in New Orleans is different than Black in Michigan, right? It's different than Black in Brazil, which is different than Black in Dominican, different than Black in Nigeria, and that's at the same day, right? What's Black now is not what's Black then. Right, yeah, y'all heard the book in Whiteness Studies about when the Irish became white? Mm-hmm. Right, well, just like whiteness changed, don't think Blackness didn't change, right? But, I mean, here's a small example, anecdotally speaking, right? Is I always think it's kind of funny when I read about people who are passing, right? And you read these books in the 1920s and 1930s about the Blacks who are passing because they were half Black or a quarter Black, right? And they passed for white. And I'm thinking, I don't know anybody who is half Black who doesn't look Black, right? I mean, or even a quarter Black who doesn't look at least not white. So my only conclusion is, what was white and what was Black then is not the same as what we call white and Black now. That's a small kind of anecdotal idea, right? But I'm like, who are these half Black people who don't look Black, right? I mean, like, really? And so, I mean, it's kind of a small thing to say, but we really can trouble what it means to be Black. What does Black mean in different contexts? What does Black mean in time? We all know that we're racially mixed in a variety of ways. We take that, we forget that, right, in some ways. So I guess, hope for the future, I would say, of womanist religious thought, we begin to trouble what it means to be Black. Also trouble what it means to be woman. Right? I mean, sexual difference and gender identity are actually really, really complicated. Right, we assume that someone's biology aligns with their gender identification, and then it comes out in a relatively feminine package, right? But that's so not always the case. So, for example, what would a womanist reading a pariah mean, right? Mm. So not only is she queer, she's ag, right? Well, what do you do with that? Well, we have to do something with that, right? So what does it mean to be a male-identified woman, right? Or what might it mean to very overtly not associate with any feminine characteristics while still saying I'm a woman, right? What does it mean to, what will we do with people who are intersex? I'm sure there's somebody Black who's intersex who thinks about religion, right, in the world. I mean, right, so I mean, there's just so much more to do with that than to assume that we know what we mean when we say Black woman. And the third aspect is trouble what it means to be religious, because so much of our work has assumed that Black women are Protestant Christians, with like three Catholics, right? M. John Coleman, Jamie Phelps, and Diana Hanks, right? And while that may be true statistically the majority, it still is not true of a whole lot of people. And so my work is kind of focused on the religious aspect and troubling what it means to be religious and not assuming that we're all Protestant Christians and definitely that we're all not Christian in the same way, right? That we're not all classical Christians, for lack of a better word, right? I don't think I'm the only one. You know what it means to be a low Christology womanist? Whoa, right? I mean, that's what I am. I'm like, well, the crosses and Jesus are nice, but whoa, you know, right? I mean, to say we actually can have one diverse Christian perspectives, number one, but even aside from that, we're not all Christian, and it's okay, right? And so what I've been really interested in is putting conversations with a womanist religious thought and what I know from my womanist and Black feminist backgrounds in conversation with those who talk about religious diversity. So there are two aspects of the conversation that have been particularly interesting to me. These are just my own personal interests, that's why I'm working on them. One has been what makes it as a world religion, right? the Orientalism conversation really did kind of set up these big five, right? White and honorary white religions. I know I said it on tape, right? Right, but I mean, dividing up the world colonially and deciding who religion got to be the big religion, right? So Judaism, Islam, Christianity, Hinduism, Buddhism, taboo, right? And then everything else was not. Was, I mean, animistic. I mean, people still write these words. I actually talked to somebody in a cab one day and talked about the axial religion. I'm like, axial religion? Are you still saying that? Like, isn't that dripping with racism? You know, the post-axial religions and the axial religions, the indigenous, the tribal, you know? I mean, I was like, did you slaughter blood on the front of the car when you said that? You know, there's this idea that there's these baser religions and then there's higher religions, and say, no, that's actually not the case. And that at this point, almost any religious tradition is a world religion, right? Because of the fact that people around the world will celebrate a particular tradition, even if it isn't their own, culturally or nationally speaking. I've been particularly interested in Yoruba traditional religions because it really is a world religion, thanks in large part to the transatlantic slave trade. But the way in which this is a religious tradition has become, by slave trade and by conscious adoption, a world religion. And why don't we get to learn that when we learn our big five, right? And to begin to push some of those boundaries as well. The other boundary I've been very interested in pushing has been around conversations of religious pluralism and theories of religious pluralism. And because time's a little tight, I won't go into it, but there are, you know, a couple major theories of religious pluralism, of how it is that different religions get along. Right, there's the, we know they're different, but they can get along well if they're solving a social problem together, right? That's my very reductionist version of Paul Nitter, right? Then there is the, if they can learn from each other, each tradition can change a little bit, right? Which is kind of my very reductionist version of John Cobb's idea. very, very reductionist version, right? And then there's the, they have different paths to the same end, right? Which is kind of hick, kind of Markheim, although Markheim would say he's not hick again, but he is. I told him that, so it's okay. But I think he is, right? That we're kind of going to different ends, or we can't quite see what's really higher than what we're looking at. It's a kind of phenomenological thing. But they all have this base assumption, right? That you're in one, that one person's a discrete tradition, trying to have a conversation or work it out with someone else is in another discrete tradition. And there's, I think, a couple problems with that. One is not everyone is really worried about this. That's another field that's a really, really, really white male field, and a white male Christian field. In fact, a really Catholic Christian white male field. And so you have to wonder, well, why are they bothered about this? And why aren't other people bothered by this? Is it because they don't know people of other religions? Of course not. It's because, and then not because no one knows how to think about it or theorize about it, but because it's not a problem. So I want to say, well, why isn't this a problem? That became one of the first questions I wanted to ask. The other question I wanted to ask is, well, this assumes that we're all in these discrete religious boxes that don't blend and mush and conform together. And I think that's not true. So even though I think a lot of us would verbally ascribe to certain belief systems, if you watch what we do, you probably believe a whole bunch of other stuff too, right? So we might call it superstitious, we might call it, this is what my grandmother did, right? Some people all say, well, I'm spiritual but not religious, and some people will say, oh, well, of course I ascribe to yoga stuff and go to church. And not just the exercise, but really kind of do namaste and feel a real connection to something that we know is a religious practice, right? So what do you do with this, right? What do you do with these kind of multiple religious activity, for lack of a better word? And I've been really fascinated with the ways in which Black studies really helps to think about this in some new ways. So whereas the white theorists working in this field are really, really, really bothered by this, right? They're like, you can't do this. This is impure for the religions. You can't go mixing things together. Only if you're like a guru in each one can you do this. This is offensive, right? To like, it just can't happen. We just have no language to talk about it. Well, one reason is because a lot of Western philosophical philosophy, religion, and philosophical theology does not talk about multiplicity. And feminists have begun to do this, but Black studies has been theorizing about cultural multiplicity for like over 100 years, right? From Du Bois' double consciousness all the way now. Like, we know how to talk about living with two-ness. We do that, right, as African Americans. And we've been theorizing about this since at least, you know, the early 1900s, if not till later. with various tropes and metaphors and ways of describing what it means to live with two-ness and what it means to live with multiplicity and what it means to live in sometimes hostile environments, but with an identity that is not singular, right, and that is not simple. So what we've been able to do culturally, well, of course, everyone who's working in this field doesn't know Black studies. Why? Because they don't. Right? And to say, well, what if you put that in conversation with this kind of hostile or tense conversation about religious multiplicity? What do we get when we do this? So this is one of the things that I'm working on. Or what do we get when we look at people, a lecture I'm giving next week, when I'm working like Ian Lavanza, right? Yoruba priestess, welcomed by the New Thought community, most of her books bought by evangelical Black Christian women. I mean, how funny is this, right? I mean, talk about multiplicity, right? And talk about, you know, and this is not someone who didn't make any money off of this, right? This is not some like marginal figure on the side of the road, you know, doing some little set, right? This is some like New York Times bestseller, profitable Oprah, right? Own talk show. Now, how she managed the money, different story. But the fact is that she made the money and she rose to prominence. This was not a marginal cultural figure, but a major cultural figure who managed to do something that religious theorists can't figure out how people do. Right? And so for me, all of this is kind of a part of what it means to trouble what it means to be religious. Right? So maybe we are spiritual, but not religious as Black persons. Maybe we are Yoruba or Yoruba-based traditions. Maybe we are, as Akasha Gloria Hole writes in her book Soul Talk, and as Layli Mapayan writes in her new book, Womanist Idea, you know, to take seriously women who do astrological charts and who use Ouija boards, and this is part of their spirituality. This is not marginal just because they don't go to a Baptist or a Methodist or a Kojic church, as we've kind of done, as we've assumed in our womanist theorizing. Which isn't to say there's anything bad about the womanist theorizing that does that, but my hope is that in the future we're willing to really trouble what it means to be religious, what it means to be woman, and what it means to be Black. Thank you.
Thank you. So I want to thank all three of you for incredible thoughts, and I would love to ask many, many questions, but I'm going to hold off because I know that I can ask you those later. I think what was so intriguing about all three of your talks was that you're all kind of opening up the idea of womanism, womanist, in very different ways and in kind of very different trajectories, and all operating out of a very interdisciplinary, multiple trajectory kind of foundation. There isn't a singular, like you were saying, Monica. So whether it's in terms of other religions, flesh, or economy, I mean, it's really fascinating. So I'd encourage everyone to come tomorrow morning to continue that part of the conversation. But I want to give us time to engage the audience, and in particular, our respondent, Dr. Miles Tribble. So we'll give the mic to... Do you want to sit down here?
Listening to the discussion that Dr. Andrea presented, one of the questions that we get often from, and excuse my back, everyone, do it this way. One of the questions that we get often from students is, how do we translate or make plain our thoughts, our reflections, our understanding, these deep questions that you're grappling with? How do we make those or enact those in practical, lived ways that we engage in our lives and with other women? So as you were talking about this rethinking of self as I am flesh in Imago Dei, how do we help and utilize that and teach that so that we can help other women, including ourselves, not perpetuate this victimization?
Mm-hmm. Shall I take the time to answer? Do we? Yeah?
Okay.
I think I kind of give you a
a quick answer.
The longer answer really is my entire book. But the quick answer is, in reframing what Imago Dei means, we usually think of the Imago Dei in terms of how we represent the image of God. And instead, I want to rethink Imago Dei as an ethical task of how to become, rather than our being, it's a becoming. So we get that, I think, solves a lot of problems about essentialist concerns and ontologizing who we are as human beings. And I, as an ethical task, that means that the Imago Dei absolutely has very practical applications. It's something that you work at every single day. So it's striving for your vocational purpose as a human person. Yeah, that's a quick answer, and I could say more, but I hope that's
okay.
Yeah.
All right. Do you want me to ask the other question?
Yeah, let's do that, and then we'll open it up to a broader.
Okay, Dr. Dei, in your critical analysis, which was very eye-opening. I heard lots of mm-hmms and amens and clapping. You talked about who we are and how we talk about ourselves as Black women, and the fact that there are obviously class differences that we tend to ignore. And so what I wanted to ask you to please talk about a little bit is how, again, in this dialogical relationship that we as women have with each other within our churches, as you talked about, in our communities, how do we begin to bridge that divide?
I'll be really quick within my own work. Something that I wish in retrospect I had of written about at the very beginning of my book. So what does it mean for me as an African-American middle-class woman to begin theorizing about poor Black women? And how am I, in these moments, being intellectually honest about my own social location in terms of class? So for example, what does it mean to call these women poor Black women? Right, I actually had a conversation with a couple of young women that, you know, the sort of categories I give in my book would fit that. And it was very interesting because, you know, one in particular really sort of, you know, she was very hesitant. Like, it didn't resonate with her, you know, that category, the idea of poor in and of itself. So that it led me, and in the book I do talk about poor as an economic marker, not as something that is to be seen culturally as like pathological, like something that that culturally they don't have, right? You know, such as being hardworking or what have you. But that's just one small example of I think oftentimes when we're not listening to each other's stories and narratives and experiences, what it means in these particular moments to humanize, for example, how I'm theorizing the subjectivity of poor Black women, but to humanize them in those moments by actually listening to their stories, I think is a departure point.
Great, thank you. And for Dr. Coleman, you talked about in Black studies and even in our lived experience, this reality of the cultural multiplicities of two-ness. But in this thinking about your project of religious pluralism, how would you suggest that theological schools, seminaries, go about actually allowing a place and space for this to happen?
Wow. We're all going to take notes on this one.
Yeah, right.
I mean, there's a simple form in terms of which, you know, don't make people check one box, you know, like you do with race, like let people check as many boxes they want to with race when you do admissions, like, well, which religious tradition, like, you check as many as you want to check, right? I think some of it would be, it's part of a larger issue, I think, that theological seminaries have, where the economic reality is caught up to an American religious reality that changed maybe 20, 30, 40 years ago, where seminaries were created for young white men who finished college to go away somewhere for 3 years to then go out and be assigned a church that would be, you know, this, their denomination would pay for them to go to seminary, pay most of it, right? Then they would go into this placement where they made a real income, right? And live out their next 40 or 50 years in parish ministry, right? Well, that changed, right? They're women, they're people of color, but we have to understand the structure we're working with was not designed for anyone but young white men going to a Bible parish assignment, right? So white men who are going to Bible parish assignment are, have a challenge, as well as people of color, as well as women, as well as people of, you know, more diverse religious identification. So we're working in a system that was not made for us. And that's important to remember. But what's good about that is women talk about being in the academy. We're working in a system that wasn't made for us, right? So we know how to work in a system not made for us. And so I think one part of that means is we have to, if we want the systems to continue, if you want theological education to continue, which I do, I love theological education. I love being a minister. I love working to train ministers. I love doing justice work. I love training people who are committed to changing the world and making it a better place because their faith motivates them to do so. And that's what theological education does at its very best, right? Is, while the number crunchers are going to be scared, and they well should be, right? Because the financial base has changed. And everything that exists now will not probably exist in 10 or 20 years, and that's disturbing and frightening, says someone with tenure at one of these places, right? So I mean, I'm not exempt from this concern. But it means having to do a radical revisioning of what it means to do theological education in today's society, right? Yeah. And doing so that in a way that is particular to your context and particular to your passion, right? So every school has a different passion. Every school has a different context geographically and religiously. So some places are still going to educate people for Episcopal ministry and send people into viable parish context. God bless them. Right? But most are going to accrue more debt than they can ever pay off.
Yes.
Unless they just partner well. Right? I mean, that's like the only way. You just keep making monthly payments till you die. You know, I mean, it's the only debt you can't shake. You just got to die to get rid of it or pay it off. And we'll probably not go into Bible parish ministry. And some people don't want to go into, you know, sustaining parish ministry. So I think a lot of what that means, going back to your concept of what it means to do this in a multiply religious way, means we need to know, for me, more than one religious tradition. Even if you identify as one, everyone in the world isn't, right? It means that we can't, I just have a word I can't say, have a negative connotation associated with those who don't fit into our denominational boxes. So, you know, in my ideal world, we would actually have classes on New Thought religion, on New Age religion, which actually aren't the same thing, right? We would actually have classes on what it means to be spiritual, not religious. There's enough literature to teach a class on that, right? I mean, so that instead of, you know, even if I'm very clearly a good AME, which I'm good, but let's imagine that I were a good, solid, you know, Bible-believing Wesleyan Methodist, right? And that's where I'm going to be. It still behooves me to know something about other traditions, and particularly the traditions that have not been well esteemed, so to say, in the history of religious thought.
Can we take about 10 minutes? Would you all be?
Yes,
okay.
Absolutely.
All right, so let's open it up to other questions. Do we need the mic for? Okay, all right. So let's start right here. There was first hand up.
Can you repeat the question? Maybe you can repeat the question.
Okay.
Hi, my name is Angelina Graham, and I know you can hear me. So my question is directed to anybody at the panel, particularly Dr. Keri, because you were talking about using it as a method, using womanist methodologies. So, as a dissertation student, I'm having issues with finding womanist work that is solid in a methodology and also empirical data. I'm actually a psychologist. I'm not in seminary school. So my framework is different. So I'm very interested in that sort of being part of third wave, fourth wave development, right? Because, yeah, we are talking specifically, I guess, about womanist theology, but I think about it as womanist thought and sort of encompassing even greater diversity in terms of divisions, fields of study, et cetera, et cetera. So I just kind of, we've been talking about that in one of the classes I was auditing, but I'm just interested in what the panel might have to say.
Absolutely, hopefully they'll join in as well. We were having this discussion earlier, interestingly. Number one, I think that you're right. I think that there is a lot of ambiguity and complexity in even attempting to name it as such in terms of womanist methodologies. There is a text that has actually began the discussion. I repeat, it begins the discussion. Dr. Stacey Floyd Thomas, a book called Mining the Motherlode, I believe, yeah, Mining the Motherlode, and a study on womanist methodologies. And she gives sort of her three classifications of how she sees womanist literature being grouped. I think the first was literary criticism, many that have used that. Second, historiography, emancipatory historiography. And I do not remember the third one, so my apologies there. But there is a third one. And I think that that sort of begins a discussion. I think that you're right, however, that part of the work perhaps will be to chart the ways in which womanist, now I'm using the term, but womanist scholars, that name themselves womanist scholars, womanist literature, the ways in which people are using, with these very interdisciplinary approaches, are using different theories in relationship to what they're theorizing. So I think that work remains, but I do think to some extent, like for example, you know, my particular work, that it's easily discernible as, you know, womanist literature that takes up critical social theory, right? So in a lot of ways, I think that people can look, can at least turn to see the work that I do and name it as falling underneath the category of critical social theory, right? Although it's using some womanist categories per se. So you're absolutely right in terms of the complexity. But you're absolutely right again that more of this needs to be charted. The discussion has begun with Dr. Floyd Thomas's book, and so hopefully that may help.
I'll add a couple of things to the conversation. One pragmatic, and that might be re-dissertations, because it's really hard to get a PhD without having a methodology section.
Right.
But they're usually not very interesting, so they don't make it into the book. So, I mean, you know, just at a pragmatic level, if you kind of pick books you like and then dig up the dissertation that came out of the book, if the book was originally a dissertation, you might find a method section there, because most of us had to have a method section to get through our doctoral committees. So that's one kind of small way you might find method that we don't name explicitly. I would say for my field as constructive theologian, I don't name my method. I actually do have a method in making a way out of no way. And I think one reason for that is that constructive theologians in general have not done a very good job of naming how do we do constructive theology. I might write an article about that. I don't know. I've been thinking about it. But we kind of do it, right? But it's not like you can find a general article on how does one do theology. You would think there would be, right? We talk about theological sources, theological norms, but we don't actually talk, and not that there's no work on theological method at all, but it doesn't any more descriptive than like, okay, let's say I want to sit around thinking theologically. How would I have a theological thought and make it into something constructive? Right? It's not, are there any articles on that?
Sure.
Yeah. I mean, yeah. There's a couple. It's old. The stuff that's out there is old, though. I mean, like 70s.
Yeah.
Right? And so, I mean, that's like 40, 50 years ago now. Right? So it's time for us probably to start writing more, I'll say from my discipline, about how it is we do what we do. Because we do it. We are somewhat conscious of it. We probably teach it. I know I do. I run around picking apart the theologians I like and put them back together and see how they did their work. So I think it's also a critique for us, just regardless of being womanist, I would say the constructive theologian, to actually be more explicit about how we do our work.
Thanks. I want to lift up two names to you. You may already know them, but just in case, Phyllis Shepherd She is, I think, a psychologist, and she's been at Boston University now for maybe a year. She just got there about a year ago. Yeah, where she's been from North Park Seminary. And I wish I could tell you the name of her book, but it's published by Dwight and Linda's.
Palgrave
Macmillan. And Nicole Phillips does psychoanalytic theory. And do you know her work?
Yes.
Yeah. She's not published yet. No, she has one piece published.
And you can dig up her dissertation.
Right.
And
yes,
you
right.
can dig up her dissertation.
From Vanderbilt.
And yeah, and she does an incredible cross transdisciplinary work.
And Lindley Mapayan is actually a developmental psychologist by training.
Okay, there's another name. Did you get that one?
Lindley Mapayan.
Yeah.
Is
formerly Lindley Phillips, but
yeah.
No, okay.
Sure. The Womanist idea.
Yeah.
Okay. All right, just a minute.
Another one back there.
Hi, thank you for such a stimulating presentation. My name is Alice Kabatahe, and I work as a chaplain, and I'd like to ask a question to Dr. White regarding seeing Imago Dei instead of just being, but as an ethical task of becoming.
Yeah.
And I was just reflecting on that as a chaplain, and when I have encounters with patients, the boundaries between being and becoming really gets very blurred. So I'd like to hear, you know, what's, and also being informed by, I practice in the Zen Buddhist tradition, apart from being an ordained Christian minister, that's again where the formlessness, like form is no other than formlessness, formless is no other than form, and I put being and becoming under that as well. So I'm just curious about how you define being and becoming and how they intersect.
Yeah, these are shorthand terms for something that's part of my hidden agenda. And I actually used to be a chaplain myself, and part of what informs my work, especially when I'm doing womanist theological anthropology, I was a hospice chaplain, but I was also a chaplain at a residential school with children and adults with developmental disabilities. And I want to make sure that folks with developmental disabilities are never left out of our anthropologies. And so when we think of the human person and the categories that make the human person in the very traditional sense, of course, being always refers to reason, autonomy, will, you know, the classic categories. And what do you do with folks who don't can't participate in activities of daily living? And so what does reason look like for them? So doing is, I think, a broader category, and I am repeating myself now, but it prevents us from limiting what it means to be a human person. So that's the subtext that, I didn't actually come out and say, but does that answer the question?
Okay. Other questions?
You have a question.
Sure.
Thank you all so much. My name is Sherry Prudhomme, and I have a question around the body of the earth and how it might fit in all of this, particularly thinking, I'm not sure about my whole question exactly, but thinking about Ivan Gabara's idea of horizontal transcendence and how that might fit in with, particularly Dr. White, your idea of the flesh instead of the body and the other, and the body being therefore a site of grace, and is there any thought around like how that could then make the body of the earth or this kind of multiplicity of unknown and different life forms that we all make up this boat together, how that could all fit together?
Thanks, it's such a great and important question, and another hole in our literature, really. And I am sadly deficient when it comes to environmental ethics and eco-womanism. but I'll say this, I think there's Let's see how to do this in less than a couple paragraphs. I guess there's a much longer answer here, but just to begin to think about it, the category of flesh does some work here in the way that I argue it subverts the subject-object dualism. And so if we can get away from dualities that are really false binaries, then our understanding of the earth is going to look a lot different, rather than it just being representative of material and then human as soul, and then all of a sudden you hierarchize creation. And I'd like to think that when I deal with eschatology in the last chapter of the book, and I'd like to think that I have in mind an eschatological understanding of creation and not just an anthropocentric understanding. But that's a very, very brief answer.
Well, I think there's an interesting connection between just mentioning Guevara and your idea of becoming.
Okay.
That could be kind of a response to that. I don't.
Yeah.
Just to give it a whole different spin, I find that one thing that's helpful about getting out of Western religious traditions is that they're kinder to the earth than a lot of Western religious traditions are. Right? And so when you're working with traditions like Europe-based traditions, like some Hinduisms, right, I mean, which is its own kind of odd category, right, where there not only is not the dualism, but where nature is embodied and sacred and feminized at times, sometimes masculinized, there's not as big a challenge, right? And I'll put it this way. Our incarnation in panentheism extends beyond humanity in many non-Western traditions, at least the ones I find particularly compelling, right? Like goddess traditions, for example, like Yoruba religious tradition does, like some Hinduisms do. And I think when you get out of that problem, that is kind of a Western philosophical problem that has seeped into our religiosity, right? It becomes a lot easier to work with what it means to be more connected to the land, right? Mm-hmm. And what it means then for all of creation to be redeemed.
Did you want to? Oh, no, I'll leave that to the theologians.
That's unethical.
Maybe we'll take one more question and then we'll. Kalia?
Hello, Kalia Jelks. This question is particularly for Dr. White, but it can also open up to anyone on the panel. But when you're speaking of just kind of the idea of the scandal of flesh, right, and then kind of really redefining the Imago Dei, how do you see worship practice actually coming into that conversation?
Yeah. So if you know Sean Copeland's book, In Fleshing Freedom, of course, that's exactly where she lands. Oh, thank you, sorry. Yeah, she lands with eschatological bodies in the Eucharistic moment. And I've been asked this question once before, and I'm going to, if you'll forgive me, I'm going to give you my very rude answer, which is, I'm Baptist. And so I have a different understanding of the Eucharist. So, yeah, okay. I really appreciate Sean Copeland's work and what she's doing on this point. Liturgical understandings, though, of it's not something I've thought about. I confess my sins. Because I'm Baptist, that's what we do. Right? American Baptist, to be specific. Anybody else want to deal with the liturgy question?
Liturgy and flesh?
Not necessarily flesh. I know, Dr. Day, you started to touch on kind of the prosperity gospel piece of it, and so that becomes a big part of worship. So what are we preaching? What's the gospel that's being preached? How do you see then in the worship moment or the worship practice really bringing in this political critique and kind of helping us begin to understand that dynamic?
Confess my sins too. I think that it's such a good and intriguing question. You know, I'm thinking, excuse me, I'm thinking about a church that I served at in Nashville, Tennessee, that was trying to craft programs reaching out to the local poor. And interestingly, brought them into the worship experience. I mean, literally, vans went to these shelters. You know, they got on the vans, brought them back to the church. And part of the struggle for the first 2 or 3 weeks was that they were sitting, these folks, near the front. And the quote-unquote middle class African American, that normally, number one, it was those were their seats, but then also they could not enter into their worship experience because, I mean, for them it was a foul smell. It disrupted their politics of sensibility, right? The politics of respectability, rather. I'm sorry, not sensibility. The politics of respectability. It totally disrupted that. And I'm thinking about, in terms of the worship moment, the ways in which, and I mean, even, you know, the people, praise and worship that goes along a lot of time within evangelical churches, and how some of the ways in which they structured the time was in response to this hostility that was going on in the pews, in the worship experience right there. That worship service in a lot of ways, I mean, the poor sinners could feel the sense of degradation. They could feel the sense of judgment that affected the entire worship experience. And I'm not sure if my answer sort of gets underneath what you're asking, but I think that, you know, part of what I talked about, sort of how it plays out in concrete ways here in that example of the worship experience, it's really telling, right? So then part of the pastor staff's responsibility was to go back and again begin to offer these types of robust critiques, you know, and provide these theological moments where people could really talk about, you know, what was going wrong. So again, I don't know if that gets underneath, but it does deeply affect the moment, you know, that many churches are struggling with, quite frankly.
To go back to Alice Walker's definition, the trope, not archaeological, which I completely agree with Dr. Day here. She talks about not a separatist except for help. Hmm. And to me, it's still an important feminist move we need to make to say we sometimes need women-only spaces.
Wow, yeah.
Right? Yeah. I was asked a question last week that is somewhat comparable. When people were asking me about something about marriage, and I was saying, "Oh, it takes more than 2 people to raise a kid," and I was like, "You know, statistically, marriage is not healthy for women, right? It's the most dangerous place, statistically speaking, for women. If you look at domestic violence statistics, right? I don't know. I think black churches are theologically dangerous places for black women to be, right? if you could say to me that theologically dangerous place, it probably isn't really good for our theological sense of self." Right, and that it is still important to have women-only spaces and to worship in those spaces as well because it's important for our health. Right, and so I think that the ways in which we might construct worship when we're by ourselves, right, when we're preaching and talking and sharing, I imagine are probably more dialectical, involve a lot more food than a wafer. Right? I think we're probably dressed a lot more comfortably, right? I mean, and just a couple things that I think might happen. I think we talk about our ancestors a lot more, right? And in ways that even if we were not explicit about them, definitely kind of the level of holiness, right? And sacrality that we find there, right? I mean, these are a couple things. So I would say women-only spaces are still needed.
Okay. Thank you. Is anyone saying a closing? Sorry.
Thank you all so very much. Thank you for your contributions here. Thank you so much to you all.
Yes. Thank you.
Thank you.